Hello, and welcome to Greet the Week. I'm Mona Duncan, and today we're going to be talking about self-evaluation and the empowerment behind it. Share the screen and get it set up. Appreciate y'all being here. And we'll start right from the very beginning. And now see the application. Okay, good deal. So we're going to go with empowerment through self-evaluation. And so three main points that stands out to me is that it helps you to know who you are and what you stand for, and that we come to an effective conclusion of who we are and what we stand for without driving ourselves crazy. And I mentioned that quite a bit when working with clients, that are you driving yourself crazy? And anyone admits to that, it's because you haven't come to a conclusion. We need to come to some kind of a conclusion. Otherwise, it'll just keep going over and over and over and over and over. And then also that we want to develop our character over our personality. The personality may be, you know, well, whatever it is, we just want to make sure that our character is in alignment with it. And so I suggest that we are all formed in our mother's womb, and regardless of those circumstances surrounding, it was, you know, anyway, we're formed in our mother's womb. And then as we go through life, we have a tendency to become deformed by the wounds of the world, because there's always things that are misunderstandings and so forth. And it just hurts, it wounds. And then we begin to conform to the way of others because we don't want to stand out like an odd person, but we are transformed through the words that we use. And that is either on the growing, that we are transformed through the words that we choose to use. And so I have a quote here from Carl Jung. He says, in each of us is the urge to become whole. Also, in each of us is the urge to remain broken. One does not become enlightened, or I should say empowered, since that's what I'm using this to be, empowered by self-evaluation. One does not become enlightened or empowered by imagining figures of light, but by making the darkness conscious. As we can begin to see, what is that hurtful tone? What is that that's still dark, that's not powerful? You know, how can we bring some light to it? And so one of my favorite quotes from Shakespeare, to thine own self be true, and it follows as closely as day follows night, thou canst not be false with any other man. When we are really true to ourselves, we cannot be false with anyone else, because that inward knowing, that inward honesty will just overpower us, and we will allow it to. So here's the premise, is that all people seek a quality world filled with maximum happiness and success and with a minimum of pain and failure. So our quality world, as defined by Dr. William Glasser, is the picture that we have in our mind. We're going through life and into the real world, and we have these five basic needs. We have the need to survive. We have a need to love and to be loved. We have a need for power or purpose. Why am I on planet Earth? We have a need for freedom, and a big part of that freedom is the choices that we make. And then we have a need for fun. And in that fun is the creative, to make something, to add colors together or whatever. And so in this real world, we choose these things to be quality. And in making those choices, we want to be balanced as opposed to juggling. You know, sometimes the word juggling, that we juggle something, it kind of smacks of being dishonest, that we are trying to rob Peter to pay Paul, that we are maybe being not as honest about finances or something. You know, it's just juggling, and it kind of smacks of dishonesty. It could mm-hmm. be like the, you know, having someone on the side and anyway, just not being open and honest. It's trying to juggle so that the other person won't find out what you're juggling about. But as we offer honest empowerment, we're looking for balance suggestions where it will help to self-regulate us. And this includes being with that equilibrium, with being steadfast, with being stable, with having the poise, not being encumbered by dishonesty. Anyway, kind of an evenness, the principles that we have within us, they're weighed and measured, and they're used effectively, and then timekeeping also. So, Winston Craig, I love this. He said, "No man chooses evil because it is evil. He mistakes it for happiness." You know, that titillating feeling, ooh, that's so good, but it can lead to things that may not be so good. It can be that whether it's the taste of the food, you know, it can lead to being satiated. It can be the alcohol. It can be the winning the lottery. It can be any of those things. We don't choose it because it is evil, but we mistake it for happiness. And oftentimes we pursue those things and we misunderstand in the choices that we've made what they lead to, that it's not always a one-time choice. It has a tendency to take on a life of its own. So what are the benefits of self-evaluating? Well, it challenges yourself to excellence. Am I really living up to my potential? It helps you to lessen your dependency on the approval of others. If you are okay, and I'm not talking about arrogance and it, despite what you may think, but if you're okay with who you are and the decisions you're making, then what other people have to say can be more information, definitely. But we don't necessarily depend on their approval to make our decisions in life. It also gives us the freedom to be true to who we are. Again, not needing other people's, not necessarily rejecting, but not needing other people's input. Then also, it helps us to promote healthy competition. Meaning that we can be working with someone, they can be better than us, they can be, you know, more proficient. And it just promotes a healthy competition of learning from others. It encourages a non-judgmental judgment, meaning that we can begin to see that someone we're working with, that they have much more talents than we have, but we can not judge them as being, well, who do they think they are? And we can also not judge ourselves as being, well, I'm a nobody. It's whenever we have those honest, open, genuine self-evaluation, it can encourage our not being so judgmental of others or of ourselves. And it's a great de-stressor just to take the stress off that I am who I am and I want to become who, you know, what all those genes are there wanting me to become. And then it's a marvelous motivator. And it helps us to be true to ourselves individually. So here is just a little list of some of the things that we can help to self-evaluate ourselves, you know, on setting goals and accomplishing them, on being effective use of time, on being credible, problem solving, creative, communication, all these kind of things, and having it on a scale of 1 to 10. And then two or three times a year, take out something like this and evaluate yourself. Where am I now on this? Am I growing or am I having a decline in those areas? Because the 1, 2, 3s are the things that need improvement. And then the on up to 8, 9, 10s are the ones that are already, you are becoming more excellent at fulfilling those. And then I look back and from the great scriptures of all times, that if anyone thinks he is something when he's not, he's deceiving himself. Each one should test his own actions. Then he can have pride in himself without comparing himself to somebody else. for each one must carry his own load. And that was spoken by the Apostle Paul, but we have to, you know, we're responsible for who we are. And so we perceive, perception is just kind of the way we see something, whether it's of us or of others or whatever. So in thinking about perception, this is some of the things, the qualifiers that I've given to it, that it's the way you see something, that your perception to us, or at least it seems to me, it becomes my reality. I mean, if that's the way I see it, then that must be the way it is. But what happens is, being human beings, we look around to see what's normal because we don't want to be the odd one out. And all are subject to perceptual biases, meaning that we tend to see or to hear only what we've already decided we want to see or to hear. It goes back to the really getting honest. And so, therefore, what we are perceiving may not be reality, may not be the real thing. We may be believing something incorrect. And here's the thing, is that our body, our total behavior, our body adjusts to the way we see things, the way we perceive them to be, which can produce anger or frustration or rejection, because our body is adjusting to the way we see how someone else may be relating to us. And so the feedback that we get is how reality interacts with us. And you kind of have to think about that. But the feedback that we get, I mean, if we declare that we're not cold and yet we're shivering, our reality is we're lying to ourselves. We really are cold. It is bringing out those shivers. So feedback is how reality interacts with us. Every thought we think has a physical component to it. So we're perceiving the things we see, the things we hear, the things we taste, and it has a physical component to it of either a like or a dislike, or because our whole body is total behavior and it all works together. And then our body adjusts to our perceptions. That's real important. I put it in there twice. And then our perceptions change as we evaluate, as we get honest with looking at what we are seeing and what we are thinking. And then Byron Katie, you're probably familiar with her. She came up with the test of perception. And I like to use this not only in teaching, but definitely for myself. And the first question to ask is it true? And that may take some research. It may take some actually finding out that something we've always believed to be true may not really be. And then how can I know that it's true? Am I being gullible? And is there a possibility that it may not be true? And then how do you behave when you think it is true? Now, to me, this is really, really powerful, because I begin, you know, and I think about the fact that I speak quite frequently that every word has infinite worth and value. Well, how do I behave when I think that that is true? I can be more kind to those that aren't kind. I can be more, have more compassion toward the person that is the robber, the raper, the maimer, the pillager. I can have more compassion toward them whenever I really do think that we as individuals have infinite worth and value. And then how can you find one good reason to hold on to this perspective? Well, for me personally, it's because if I really begin to look at what a jerk that person is, I can get real offended toward them. I can get real pushy off toward them, because I was talking with someone yesterday, how the fact that what we perceive about something, someone else, what we really kind of dislike in someone else is a pretty good indication that that's something we're doing, that they're just showing us who we really are. And so what is one good reason you can hold on to the perception that you have? And then who would you be if you did not think this way? So I think if I did not think that everyone has infinite worth and value, you know what? I think that there's a lot of people I just wouldn't like at all. So, but you'll have to come up with those things on your own. So what are some of the things that keep us from evaluating and getting honest? One is to continually justify, to rationalize, yeah, but, or to deny it. Well, I just don't believe it. Because, and your non-believing may be truth, but what if it's not? What if it really is reality? And so it's being willing to look at what is right before us to see if there's any reality to it rather than just automatically denying it. Sometimes we can be real dishonest with ourselves and real fearful. So to be empowered, it's to make a decision to look at what are your top assets, to live in the presence, realize that this is the only moment that we have at our disposal, to establish a benchmark of success, and to set up some kind of a roadmap that we can recover whenever we have made those fumbles. So the dilemma is, if you always do what you've always done, you'll always get what you've always got. I'm not sure whether that was Einstein, that it was someone. And so I like to add to that, is it enough? And to me, as I look at doing what I've always done and getting what I've always got, the majority of the times, no, it's not enough. Because you know what? When I get real honest with me, I know I can really do a little bit better. So the self-evaluation, and this is from the topics, it was the chapters from Les Brown. And he says, chapter number one was, it's possible. Whenever you begin to see some things that could improve your life, but you're kind of afraid to do it, and well, I've tried things like that before and it didn't happen, it's to come back and to realize the fact that it is possible. Because if it wasn't possible, I don't know, maybe we wouldn't have even thought it. We would have, you know, discounted it right up front. Then it's necessary. Whenever we see that it's possible and we begin to grow, we begin to have this feeling inside that, yeah, it's a need. I need to do this. It's necessary that this be carried out. And then it's you. It's who you really are. It's that inwardness of you that's waking up, that's beginning to see that this is your personality. This is your character. This is who you are. And then it's hard. Oh, yes. But it's possible. It's necessary you follow through on it because it's you. It's who you really are. And yeah, it is hard. There are some difficult steps. There are some things to overcome. But then it's worth it. It's worth that others being, you know, maybe discouraging. It's worth it to have that sweat and tears. It's worth it to have those difficult things happen because it's showing us how possible, necessary it is. And then it's done. And the beautiful thing is in the chapter of it's done, is that we're already beginning to succeed even when things aren't measuring up to what we had thought it would be. Because it's already done. Once we really believe it, then we can achieve it. If I believe it, then I can achieve it. And it's already done sometimes before we're signed off on the contract. And so, Chinese proverb, tension is who you think you should be. Relaxation is who you are. And in 2006, when I went to, I had a book that I'd published and it had been accepted by Linda Harshman and could be displayed at the International Convention of Glasser Institute. And so I was, had gotten there early and had set up my desk and everything. And I was looking out the window and there was a river out there and it was beautiful and it was so pretty, but I was kind of tense inside. And I remembered this Chinese proverb, tension is who you think you should be. And I'm thinking there, well, you know, nobody's ever heard of Mona Duncan. And then I remembered relaxation is who you are. Just relax into who you are because as long as we're still alive, there's still that possibility of growth. And so relieve that tension by relaxing into who you are right here, right now, today, knowing that every day is a new possibility. And then also the old familiar and wonderful Henry David Thoreau. If one advances confidently in the direction of his dreams and endeavors to live the life that he's imagined, he will meet with success unexpected in common hours. And I believe that. And thank you for being here. Stop sharing, but I also want to stop the recording. And those of you that are here will be open for conversation.